Well, good morning, everyone. Pleasure to welcome you to our cardiology grand rounds, close to the holiday season. And I think it's a great topic, actually, to keep us rejuvenated, regenerated, and young, looking forward to 2017. And it's a pleasure to introduce our guest, our speaker this morning, Dr. Cooke, John Cooke, who is no stranger to any of this audience here, but certainly we were so pleased to be able to recruit him to the DeBakey Heart and Vascular Center in 2013, and he's already made his mark in many discoveries. One of them has been, at least of us, past year, selected among the best publications in circulation research regarding the effect of proton inhibitors on endothelial function. So I can tell you what his interest has been throughout his academic career. Was at Mayo Clinic, did his PhD in physiology at Mayo Clinic, went to Harvard, then recruited in 1990 to Stanford to head their vascular biology program and institute. And there, I think he's also made his mark on many discoveries regarding to cardiac regeneration and vascular biology. For us in cardiology, you know, vasculature is a bit distant from the heart, but let me tell you, it has shown itself to be so important because actually it affects the vasculature of the coronaries in addition to everything else in the body. And his contributions have been really enormous. He's had more than 500 publications in prestigious journals. He was president of the Society of Vascular Medicine, director of the board of vascular medicine, and really has made his mark on that. So we were so pleased that he brought his crew and actually added to his crew from Stanford here at the Research Institute. And he will share with us today therapeutic manipulations of cell fate for cardiovascular regeneration. John, pleasure to have you.
Thank you, Bill, for that kind introduction. Thanks for giving a shout out to vasculature also. It's something we don't talk as much as we should about. And you notice I changed the title of Cardiology Grand Rounds to Cardiovascular Grand Rounds. I hope you don't mind. So thank you all for coming this morning. So we're going to talk about therapeutic manipulation of cell fate for cardiovascular regeneration. And some of you are probably now thinking, why am I sitting here? But I think I'm going to try to show you the clinical relevance of this topic, why it's important to you as a cardiologist. We'll talk about why cell fate is important to us, cardiac fibrosis versus regeneration, and then this concept of transdifferentiation and the mechanisms of transdifferentiation, and the potential clinical implications of this work. Now, let me give you one example of why cell fate is important to us. Heart failure is a frequent complication of myocardial infarction. Within 30 days of MI, about a quarter of the patients that have had a heart attack are going to develop heart failure. And that's related to the size of the infarct, persistent ischemia, mechanical complications like papillary muscle rupture, stunned hibernating myocardium, ventricular remodeling, and most of all is a fibrotic response to myocardial injury. So you see an acute infarct here, courtesy Frank Netter here, wonderful illustrator of medical conditions. So acute infarct, and then you know that over time there's an inflammatory phase and cardiac fibroblasts migrate in and generate a lot of extracellular matrix, and you get the formation of a scar. And you can get with that formation of a scar adverse remodeling so that the ventricular volumes are greater, increasing the tension on the wall of the heart and further impairing function. And even if you don't get the adverse remodeling, this scar is non-contractile. It doesn't have compliant properties, and you get diastolic as well as systolic dysfunction. Right now, our therapies for treating heart failure to prevent it, first of all, by restoring perfusion and reducing myocardial demand, slowing the heart down, reducing the blood pressure, and reducing neurohormonal activation with ACE inhibitors, angiotensin receptor blockers, aldosterone antagonism, reducing the edema, and in worst cases, inotropic support. But what about myocardial regeneration? What about transforming that scar into tissue? Is that possible? Well, it is. It is possible. It occurs in lower vertebrates, in the newt, in zebrafish. Experimental studies have shown that if you damage the heart, these animals can fully regenerate the heart with tissue. Now, I'm showing a picture here of Johnny Matrone because he established a model at his previous postdoc of myocardial injury, laser-induced injury in the zebrafish. And here at Methodist in our Center for Cardiovascular Regeneration, he's doing superb work in vascular development and regeneration, and was one of the American Heart Association Young Investigator awardees this year. So lower vertebrates can heal with tissue, humans scar. And why is that? Well, in the zebrafish heart, in lower vertebrates, it turns out that after a severe injury, you can amputate the tip of the heart, the apex of the heart in these animals, and they'll fully regenerate. The way they do it is by forming, well, basically a blastema. The cells around the injury de-differentiate and proliferate and migrate into this area. So cardiomyocytes are actually de-differentiating, proliferating, migrating into this area, as well as fibroblasts. Fibroblasts are migrating into that area too, and you get some scar formation, but the cardiomyocytes come in and they replace that injury, that injured area, and recreate the normal tissue. And then once they have migrated into that area, they re-differentiate into mature cardiomyocytes. Mature cardiomyocytes can't divide, but in the de-differentiated form, they can. Well, does that happen in humans? Can it happen in humans? Well, it does, actually. It does actually happen. That process occurs, but at a very low rate. In fact, by the end of our life, we replace about half of our heart over time. There's slow replacement of cardiomyocytes. And that's in part due to progenitor cells, very small number of progenitor cells in the heart, c-kit positive cells that can form cardiomyocytes, but that's a very small number. There's also some amount of cardiomyocyte division, but as I mentioned to you, mature cardiomyocytes can't divide, but they can, you get some amount of de-differentiation so that these cells can divide, and then they reform mature cardiomyocytes. So that process occurs very slowly in the young heart and ever slower in the elderly heart. Well, can we modify that process? I think we can. And today, I'm going to talk about reprogramming fibroblasts. Now, Deepak Srivastava at UCSF was the first to reprogram cardiac fibroblasts into heart cells, cardiomyocytes, fully mature, contracting cardiomyocytes. We're taking a complementary approach that's also necessary if you want to create a functional tissue, and that is to reprogram fibroblasts into vascular cells. So I'm going to talk about that now, and we're going to get into some heavy biology, so if you need to get up and have another cup of coffee, please do. So I'm going to tell you what our secret sauce is to change a fibroblast. These are fibroblasts shown on the left into endothelial cells. We call endothelial cells derived from fibroblasts induced endothelial cells, IECs. So how do we do that? That's what we're going to talk about now. We'll get into a little biology. But before we get into the biology, let me tell you why it's important. Because I think that we have the glimmers now, beginnings of a therapy for vascular regeneration, which is absolutely important to heal any tissue injury, including a myocardial infarct or any other wound. And we have developed a small molecule cocktail for changing fibroblasts, scar cells, into vascular cells. And the idea would be, in the case of a heart attack, would be to provide this small molecule cocktail at the time of the MI, so that some of those cardiac fibroblasts migrating into the lesion, migrating into the area of injury, are transformed into vascular cells that will provide, that will self-assemble, which they do, into capillaries, and provide the nutrition and the niche for true cardiac repair. So that's the idea. And we can also do this for other fibrosing diseases, too, change the fibroblasts into vascular cells. Because fibroblasts, if a scar basically is an avascular area of connective tissue, and you can imagine that an avascular desert like that is not going to support cells that you're injecting into the heart. But if we can change that forming scar into a vascular network, now we have the scaffold on which we can have true cardiac regeneration. So that's the idea. Now, some of you might be thinking, like I see Henry Pownall sitting there, his arms crossed, somewhat skeptical. I'm just kidding, Henry. But truly, I mean, it is, we're just at the beginnings of this. But Bill, you know Mark Pfeffer, right? I remember 30 years ago, walking down the hall of the Brigham Women's Hospital, I saw Mark coming toward me with a cart. The cart was covered. Couldn't see what was in it. So I said, "Hey, Mark, how you doing? What you got there?" And he said, "Rats." And I said, "Okay. What are you doing with the rats?" He said, "Well, I just gave them all a heart attack." And I said, "Oh, okay." And I said, "Why did you do that?" And he said, "Well, I have this hypothesis about captopril. I think captopril might reduce the injury to the heart." And I said, "Oh, really?" We talked a little bit about neurohormonal activation and its adverse effect on the heart after an injury. You know what that led to, right? That was 30 years ago. That led to the SAVE study and the SOLVE study, which showed that ACE inhibitors can save lives. So these drugs that we were using for high blood pressure could actually save lives of people that had a heart attack. And we learned later that they had a lot of other biological effects on remodeling of the heart. Well, that's where we are now. So, you know, fast forward 30 years and we are at the beginning. We're not rolling rats down the hall. Can't do that at Methodist. But we do have zebrafish and we have mice, and they are helping us learn more about vascular regeneration. So we're getting there. This fella, you may know, is Shinya Yamanaka. And we have to thank him for propelling us in this new direction of transdifferentiation, because Shinya Yamanaka in 2006 showed that you could take a fibroblast and turn it into what he called an iPSC, an induced pluripotent stem cell. So he changed a fibroblast, a scar cell, into something that was pluripotent, basically like an embryonic stem cell. These iPSCs are like, they're very, very similar to an embryonic stem cell. They can become anything, endoderm, ectoderm, mesoderm, all the germ layers, any cell in the body, and it's just a remarkable discovery. So he publishes his first paper in 2006, gets the Nobel Prize in Medicine 2012 for that, so land speed record for getting the Nobel Prize. And it's because of the power of this technology. These induced pluripotent stem cells can be derived from skin. You can take the skin of a person and turn the fibroblasts into these iPSCs. And then you can differentiate those into anything. And you can study the pathobiology of the brain and this, the neurons in this individual. It's very difficult to get at the neurons of this individual, but if you make an iPSC and differentiate it into a neuron, now you can study the pathobiology of some poorly understood neurological disease. And you can screen. You can do screening for drugs that may reverse the pathobiology. And potentially you could use these cells for regeneration. And we were interested in the latter quite a few years ago. We started taking fibroblasts and generating the iPSCs using the Yamanaka technique, and then differentiating those into vascular cells. And the idea would be, you know, maybe we could use these cells with extracellular matrix to create blood vessels. That was what we were thinking. And we were actually successful in doing that, making iPSCs using a Yamanaka technique and differentiating those into endothelial cells. And I'm not going to go through the whole process with you, but just to show you that the end result is something that looks very much like an endothelial cell. It's expressing all the markers of an endothelial cell, CD31, CD144. They make eNOS, they generate nitric oxide. They form these capillary-like networks in Matrigel. And so they do everything that endothelial cells are supposed to do. And when we put them in, these are human iPSC-derived endothelial cells. So we take human fibroblasts, we generate iPSCs, we differentiate them into endothelial cells, and we put them into Matrigel, basically a gel that provides growth factors to keep them alive, and we inject that into an immunodeficient mouse. And we look to see what happens. And these human endothelial cells self-assemble into vessels. So, and in fact, if you look closely, you can see red blood cells coursing through these capillaries. They actually hook up with the murine network, vascular network, and they're functional. Blood is coursing through these vessels in the Matrigel plug in the animal. So that's exciting. And then we show, this is Nan Wong, who was a postdoc with me at the time at Stanford, and she is now assistant professor at Stanford. She showed very nicely that injecting these cells into the ischemic hind limb of the mouse could improve blood flow. This is blood flow, this is time, and there is a modest improvement with the injection of these cells into the hind limb. I'm not saying that's the way they should be delivered. In fact, I don't think cell therapy, you know, injections into ischemic tissue is ever going to give us much benefit. I think it's much better. The approach that I'm talking to you about today is a much better approach. That is, take the cells that are already there and get them to do what they should be doing, like what they do in a lower vertebrate, and that is to regenerate the tissue. Any event, we wanted to make iPSCs using without viruses. So Yamanaka had used a retrovirus to get the genes encoding the Yamanaka factors into the cell. Yeah, there's four Yamanaka factors that regulate pluripotency. OCT4, SOX2, KL4, c-MYC are transcriptional factors that turn on a whole core network of pluripotent genes, genes that you need for pluripotency. So you just get those four genes into a cell and you can get an iPSC. So that's what Shinya Yamanaka got the Nobel Prize for. But he was using a retrovirus to get the gene into cells. And you're messing with the human genome. We didn't want to do that. We're physician scientists. We want to make something that's useful for people. So we had a different approach. We generated cell permeant peptides of the Yamanaka factors, OCT4, SOX2, KL4, c-MYC, and we showed that they could actually get into the cells. First of all, they worked. They bound to their consensus sequence. They got into cells, and then Erwin Hunter was supposed to optimize the dose of the peptides so that we could get iPSCs. But that experiment never worked. We couldn't get the peptides to actually function, to actually produce an iPSC. So what was going wrong? I mean, we were using the Yamanaka factors as proteins, so it was a different approach than using a virus to get the genes in. But it should have worked. We were getting the protein inside of the cells. In fact, we even showed that the if we knocked down one of these proteins in an iPSC, we could rescue the iPSC with the protein. So the proteins were getting into the cell, they were doing their job, but the fibroblasts, they couldn't make iPSCs. And that failure led to this paper in Cell. Jun Lee, I'm postdoc at the time, was the first author on that paper. And we showed that the Yamanaka approach, in addition to providing these factors that are absolutely critical for pluripotency, the Yamanaka approach also requires innate immune activation. So the retrovirus that Yamanaka was using actually was playing a role in this process by activating innate immunity. And so we began to understand a lot more about this process. So this paper was published in Cell in 2012, and it was the same month that Yamanaka got his Nobel Prize for showing that these factors could induce pluripotency. But basically, we showed that he was half right. And I'm not saying that with irony, it's just true. These factors are absolutely critical. They provide transcriptional directionality, but you have to have activation of innate immunity. And let me show you why. Just a little bit of data. as I mentioned to you, these Yamanaka factors, in this case, this is one of them, SOX2, being delivered to the fibroblast with a retroviral vector, activates all the downstream genes needed for pluripotency. So this is NANOG. This is one of those genes that's important. And it gets activated by the viral retroviral SOX2. But you notice we weren't getting any activation with the cell-permeant peptide. So the cell-permeant peptide is getting in, but it's not doing its job. This retrovirus is getting the gene in, and it's activating downstream genes. We saw this also with another transcriptional factor, OCT4, another Yamanaka factor. We get immediate activation with the viral form of it, but not with the protein form of it. And this is a longer course, time course, and you can see we get a strong activation of this important downstream pluripotency gene, but not much with the cell-permeant factor. And it occurred to us that maybe the virus was having some effect, so we added an irrelevant virus, and now everything worked. This is an irrelevant virus. It shouldn't have had any effect at all, but when we added that with the cell-permeant peptide, now all the downstream genes, we're just showing one here, were being activated. So retroviral GFP, which should have no effect other than turning the cell green, plus the cell-permeant SOX2, Now we could see activation of the downstream genes. So basically what we learned with our colleague Ed Makarski at Stanford, we learned that the retroviral vector was actually activating innate immunity, and that activation of innate immunity followed the usual signaling pathways that everyone knows turns on the production of inflammatory cytokines, but we found a different limb of the pathway. And the different limb of the pathway was activation of epigenetic modifiers. I'll show you that in a moment. But here's just one piece of data. This is what an iPSC colony looks like 30 days after delivering the Yamanaka factors. So we've taken fibroblasts, we've given them Yamanaka factors using the retroviral vector, and we get these colonies. So these are colonies of iPSCs. These are pluripotent cells. There's hundreds of maybe 400, 500 cells packed in here in the colony. They look very different from the fibroblasts. If you're looking at them individually, fibroblasts are stellate, they're elongated. These things are round, the nucleus is very large. And if we knocked out elements of the innate immune pathway that responds to retrovirus, TRIF and TLR3, we were no longer getting these colonies. So activation of innate immunity was critical for the generation of these colonies using the Yamanaka approach. So the Yamanaka approach doesn't work if you knock out innate immune activation. And to make a long story short, what we found was that a whole new limb of innate immune activation, and that is a change in epigenetic factors that allows the chromatin to open up. So in a fibroblast, where you have pluripotent genes, they are locked down. They're in this closed conformation in the chromatin. You're not expressing those pluripotency genes because they are locked down in chromatin. They're tightly wrapped around histone proteins. So in violet here is the DNA, tightly wrapped around the histone proteins shown in blue. And transcriptional factors have no access. So these genes are silent. They're silenced in a fibroblast. And that makes sense. It's a fibroblast. It's not a pluripotent cell. But with activation of innate immunity, you have an open chromatin configuration occur. And now these transcriptional factors can act. Yamanaka factors could not act on the fibroblast as proteins. They could only act when the chromatin was open, and that required activation of innate immunity. And so I think the larger concept here is that activation of innate immunity by anything, by viruses, bacteria, which present these pathogen-associated molecular patterns to the cell, or damage, like after an infarct, which presents damage-associated molecular patterns to the cell, it activates various toll-like receptors. There's a whole family, TLR 1 to 10, and there's a receptor, the RAGE receptor and RIG1. Anyway, these things can sense different patterns and then activate a common pathway, this well-known innate immune pathway, to activate the production of inflammatory cytokines, but also what we discovered was to open up the chromatin. So that's a whole new concept in innate immunity. Now, once you have an open chromatin, the cell is in a state of epigenetic plasticity. This makes a lot of sense, because if you're a cell and you're being attacked by a pathogen or there's damage in your environment, you have to respond to that. And if you have phenotypic fluidity, if you're able to change your shape, change your function, you can respond to the changing environment. You can respond to the pathogen. So this is a larger concept. Now, we're using this concept for transdifferentiation, but I think it's a larger concept than that. And we've shown that this pathway is important in the generation of induced pluripotent stem cells, and we've shown this pattern, pathway is important in transdifferentiation of fibroblast endothelial cells. Now, here's something that clinicians will appreciate. There is a Goldilocks zone for innate immune activation and this phenomenon of epigenetic plasticity. There is a zone of innate immune activation that is optimal. If you have too much innate immune activation, you can't get reprogramming. If you have too little innate immune activation, you can't get reprogramming. There's an optimal zone. What you're seeing here is basically the data that we got from reprogramming, using a reprogramming system. These are fibroblasts that have a cassette of the Yamanaka factors embedded in them already. That's activated by doxycycline. So we can add doxycycline to these fibroblasts, murine fibroblasts, and it'll activate the Yamanaka cassette. All the Yamanaka factors will now be produced, and these fibroblasts change into iPSCs. These are iPSC colonies here that you see. And we use this system, and we increased activation of innate immunity. And you can see that in this case, we're adding poly-IC, which is a TLR3 agonist that's approved by the FDA for innate immune activation. You can see that as we increase innate immune activation, we get an increase in NF-kappa-B. The NF-kappa-B is a major regulator of innate immune activation. So this is, we have an NF-kappa-B construct driving luciferase, and we can see, actually visually see, the innate immune activation lighting up these cells. So that increases over time. But the ability to generate colonies kind of plateaus and comes down with excessive innate immune activation. The cells are still alive. They're still alive, but they can't reprogram. They're in a state of epigenetic rigidity over here. So back to the clinicians that are sitting in the audience, what does this sound like? Okay, this sounds like optimal healing. This sounds like someone who's immunosuppressed with steroids. You have a reduction in activation of inflammation, and you don't get healing, right? This patient on steroids. And the diabetologist will recognize that patients with diabetic foot ulcers have a ring of inflammation around the non-healing wound. Excessive activation of innate immunity and adaptive immunity and impaired healing. So too much inflammation, too little inflammation, not enough healing. You have to have an optimal zone of inflammation. All right, so now I'm going to tell you how we change fibroblasts into endothelial cells. And the current cocktail that we have that has been improved by Xu Meng still needs a little bit of work. It's still a little complex, but it involves innate immune activation. And then once the cells are in a state of epigenetic plasticity, we provide factors, growth factors that enhance, that push them toward endothelial phenotype. So we've done this successfully, published this last year, and I won't go through the whole protocol, but it basically is what I just said. Activate innate immunity, we do it with poly-IC, we add a few growth factors that favor endothelial lineage, and we get a small amount of endothelial cells, not a lot. So this is like the Wright brothers, going 200 feet, 2% of our fibroblasts turn into endothelial cells. But they're genuine endothelial cells. This is transcriptional profiling of fibroblasts versus our induced endothelial cells by comparison to human microvascular endothelial cells. And you can see that the parental fibroblasts are very different from the genuine endothelial cells. And the induced endothelial cells are much more similar to the human microvascular endothelial cells. Those of you who aren't used to looking at these this hierarchical clustering, a heat map of gene expression, each of these rows is a different gene. Each of these columns represents a cell type. So these are all fibroblasts, and you're looking at the gene expression. You're looking at thousands of genes here, by comparison to the expression of those genes in IECs and human microvascular endothelial cells. And the intensity of the gene expression is shown by the color. So red is most intense, black is least intense. That's how you look at these things. Our work in analyzing these transcriptional profiles, thousands of genes, expression of which is needs to be analyzed, compared. We're much better at this now because we have a bioinformatics group led by Kai-Fu Chen. I don't know if he's here today, but he's a junior faculty member who's brought us a lot of expertise in bioinformatics. This is Shu Meng. Shu also was one of the Young Investigator Awardees of the American Heart Association this year. We had two of the four Young Investigator Award finalists for the ATVB at American Heart Association were our guys. Someone else was from Toronto, someone else was from UCSF, I think, or Seattle. So we had two in that national competition, international competition. So Shu has refined the cocktail for generating endothelial cells from fibroblasts. And we're getting now, we're up to 15% of a field of fibroblasts we can convert to endothelial cells. And still, you know, we need to work on it a little bit more. But as I said, you know, we're the Wright brothers just taking off and going 200 feet. But she's been able to show these endothelial cells are functional. They form networks. They make nitric oxide. They make angiogenic cytokines. And they form capillaries in Matrigel that's injected into a mouse. And they also have some therapeutic potential, too. What you're seeing is here is a hind limb ischemia model. And after the ligation of the femoral artery, we see in all the groups, the control, those injected with IECs in green, those injected with authentic endothelial cells in red, we see that blood flow is about 20% of normal. And then over time, everyone gets better. But those that had the cell injections are just a little bit more better. Again, a modest effect. I don't think this is the right way to do regeneration, to inject cells into an ischemic area. But it basically is just proof of concept that these cells can make angiogenic cytokines and increase capillary density. They do. They increase capillary density. They enhance the microvasculature of the mouse locally. You can see an increase in capillary density. This is the quantification of that. And a reduction in injury to the hind limb, less necrosis. Now, one thing I've been interested in for 25 years is NO, nitric oxide, and it's known that iNOS, the gene that produces inducible NO synthase, plays a critical role in the innate immune response. So macrophage make a lot of nitric oxide, and it's due to the activation of iNOS. Also, any cell that's in a situation of inflammation produces this gene, including endothelial cells, which normally produce ENOS, endothelial NO synthase. But iNOS has a thousandfold greater catalytic activity than ENOS. It produces huge amounts of NO, and it outstrips the supply of arginine and starts producing superoxide anion. The combination of superoxide anion and nitric oxide is the fastest chemical reaction known to man. It forms peroxynitrate anion, which destroys bacteria. So this is what you're seeing here is a cell, and the cell is being activated by the pathogen-associated molecular patterns of this bacteria, and it's causing the induction of NO synthase, the production of NO, which is shown to be acting on various proteins in the bacteria to kill it. So NO is an important mediator of pathogenic response with inflammation. So we were interested, okay, if that's true, we were wondering if it might be important in transdifferentiation. So remember, we're activating innate immunity to get epigenetic plasticity. Does NO play a role in this? So Shu Meng showed that, in fact, during this process of epigenetic plasticity, where we're transdifferentiating fibroblasts into endothelial cells, there is a marked increase in iNOS expression. And by the time the fibroblasts become endothelial cells, we start to see ENOS being produced. But these are in mature endothelial cells. Neuronal NO synthase is not generated. But early on in this transdifferentiation process, she sees iNOS getting activated. So the question is it really important for transdifferentiation? And so she took some iNOS knockout fibroblasts and tried to transdifferentiate them into endothelial cells. This is a FACS analysis showing you that in our wild-type fibroblasts, we get about 5% endothelial cells from our fibroblasts using this transdifferentiation approach. A small number, but proof of concept that this idea works. But with an iNOS knockout, we get nothing, really. And this is the quantification of that. So iNOS is important. And that was fun for us because we've been studying this molecule, nitric oxide, for years and years. And then the question was, how is that possible? How is NO acting on the cell to enhance this transdifferentiation process? Actually, it was really very cool. We saw that, Xu saw that iNOS was translocating to the nucleus. So these are control cells. iNOS is a protein. It's out in the cytoplasm. But what's interesting is when you activate innate immunity, it gets into the nucleus. Well, what is it doing there? It doesn't normally belong in the nucleus, but this protein that produces nitric oxide is migrating to the nucleus. You can clearly see it here. Here, look, the nucleus is dark. The iNOS is outside of the nucleus, and after activation of innate immunity, the iNOS is moving into the nucleus. And there's more of it in the cytoplasm as well, but it's moving into the nucleus. So why is that important? Well, I'll make a long story short. This was, Xu just published this work in Circulation Research this year. And basically, what she showed was that iNOS is binding to a epigenetic modifier, ring 1, that is part of the polycomb complex. The polycomb complex suppresses epigenetic plasticity. It suppresses gene expression. So basically, the nitrosylation of ring 1, and again, it's a very complex diagram, but the idea is that nitrosylation of ring 1 causes this complex to fall apart, and you lose the suppressive influence of this complex. So this is a good thing for epigenetic plasticity. It increases the open chromatin state. So basically, this is what she showed, this diagram. And the idea is that NO is very important in this open chromatin configuration. So it changes the closed conformation in the fibroblast to an open conformation that allows the transcriptional factors to work. So it enhances epigenetic plasticity. And the mechanism was very well defined by Xu Meng in that paper. So we can directly reprogram fibroblast endothelial cells. And right now it's not a high yield, but we've shown that it's possible. We want to improve this process, and we want to prevent fibrotic diseases. So the clinical applications are development of a small molecule cocktail for changing fibroblasts into vascular cells. The idea would be these IECs would self-assemble into capillaries and provide the microvasculature nutrition and a niche for true cardiac repair. We can use this to halt or reverse fibrosing diseases. Working with Arvind Abhimaraj and Keith Uecker and your group, Arvind, we're talking now about how to use this, apply this idea to cardiac fibrosis, diastolic dysfunction. And we might be using RNA from Dr. Bruno's RNA core rather than small molecules. It might be more effective to use the RNA, and you also get the advantage of activation of innate immunity with the RNA. Topical cream to reverse or halt keloid formation, scar formation. It could be useful for healing diabetic wounds. So we're looking for corporate partners to help us develop this approach and trying to get some AHA and NIH money to support it. And I think you have some nice animal models of cardiac fibrosis. We have imaging, so we could once we develop this in preclinical models, we can take it to you, Bill, and you can tell us if it's working in patients with cardiac fibrosis. So that's a cardiovascular application of this idea, but it's a much more global idea that cells do sense damage-associated molecular patterns, pathogen-associated molecular patterns, and it activates an inflammatory signaling pathway that's been very well worked out, very well described with release of inflammatory cytokines. Our contribution to this area is learning that this same pathway causes global changes in epigenetic modifiers, changes in their expression, and the amount of those epigenetic modifiers. It changes the balance, so we see more expression of histone acetyltransferase, something that enhances epigenetic plasticity, less expression of HDACs, which reduce epigenetic plasticity. We see nitrosylation of epigenetic modifiers that causes a change in the activity of the epigenetic modifiers. So basically, we get this open chromatin configuration that now that we know this to be true, we can manipulate this process therapeutically. That's the idea. And this is the group that's helping me do this work. I've talked about some of them as we went along, and I'm very proud of these guys. They're doing spectacular work, and I've just given you a little view of what we're doing today. This is Kai-Fu Chen. I talked to him about him earlier, his bioinformatic profiling, and Dr. Bruno with their mRNA work, and Johnny Matrone are particularly involved in this, and I don't see Shu here. She's somewhere here, but Shu, are you here? Anyway, Shu, you saw a picture of her earlier. She had the brilliant paper in Circulation Research showing the importance of nitrosylation in this process. So we'll do it. We're going to get there. A lot of other great ideas coming from this group that we really want to do fundamental research that transforms cardiovascular care. We want to do it here with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, John. You can tell amazing work and how much work goes behind the scene and how much also do we need more information to be able to do this.
Yeah.
I'll have one or two questions before people. One is, since it is demonstrated in the animal, in nature, that this can occur, let's say in the zebrafish, and you mentioned that there is really this Goldilocks phenomenon of appropriate inflammation. In the infarct of either the larger animal or in human, do we have an idea whether inflammation is too much at this stage of the game, or is it too little?
That's a great question. Anyway, you asked a great question. It's the same question we're asking right now. And I think in man, I think we're on the wrong side of the Goldilocks zone. Innate immune activation is excessive. It's excessive, and it may explain why we don't have the same amount of regeneration as lower vertebrates. But it might also be protective, because I think if you have a very strong response to pathogen-associated molecular patterns, you're going to live longer. I mean, 100 years ago, what was killing most of us was infectious disease, and that was the plague on humanity from the beginning, was infectious disease and trauma, yeah. Damage and pathogens. And so we had a very strong response to the pathogens. We traded our regenerative capacity for a stronger response against pathogens, and that allowed us to get to where we are now.
I mean, it's interesting putting it together with earlier data on modifying inflammation. Steroids, obviously, if you reduce it so much, you're not gonna get as much healing and more complications. So there's this happy medium,
right?
Likely somewhere.
I remember, 30 years ago when there was that trial with steroids, in myocardial infarction, to see if by reducing inflammation in the setting of a myocardial infarction, you could improve healing. That was the idea.
Exactly.
And that trial was stopped, right? Because of ventricular rupture. So the steroids were impairing healing.
Maybe too much suppression.
Yeah.
Questions?
Doctor, I think, and we're very grateful to your presence here and the amount kind of work. It's very inspirational. I think this is really the leading of science, and we're happy to have your mentorship for this. A couple of questions that I have is, in the context of the toll-like receptors being activated, it's the fibroblasts, the receptors on the fibroblasts. Now, is it a direct activation from the injury agent like viruses and bacteria directly, or is it a role of the immune system like T-reg cells or B-reg cells in controlling it or modulating it? Mm-hmm. My second question is, has the concept of transformation also been looked at in the transdifferentiation from in EMT? I don't know, I haven't seen any literature, but I don't know if that's something that's also an avenue.
Those are two great questions. So. There's innate immunity and there's adaptive immunity. So innate immunity is the ability of a cell to see a pathogen, the ability of a cell to see damage and respond to it.
So that ability is, I believe, all cells have that ability to a certain extent. There's different TLR receptors. There's different repertoire. But most cells have that ability to adapt to a pathogen. Then there's adaptive immunity, which, of course, is activation of T cells and B cells, or production of antibodies and killer T cells that are, you know, directed toward a particular antigen. That's the adaptive immunity. I'm talking today about innate immunity. And it is true that adaptive immunity plays a role in regeneration as well. But I was focusing today on the cell autonomous response to injury and the ability of a cell to transdifferentiate. Your other question was, what Dr. Bimraj is referring to is endothelial to mesenchyme transition that is thought to play a role in cardiac fibrosis. It may play a huge role in cardiac fibrosis, this transdifferentiation of endothelial cells to fibroblasts. So the reverse reaction. And there's some very good evidence that may account for a lot of the fibrosis in diabetes, diabetic cardiac fibrosis. I don't know if anyone's looked at the role of innate immunity in that response. I think it's a good question. I think we should do that.
Jerry? John, fantastic talk. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Jerry.
I'm interested in your thought about what you think's going to happen in the end. To regenerate a heart, you need the right cell, myocyte, you need the extracellular matrix, you need the capillary density. And so how I see this, certainly the small molecule cocktail, understanding the underlying mechanism, but do you think it's going to be multiple cocktails? And what is it you think ultimately, and I know I'm asking you to anticipate, we're in the early grounds of the taking off, so to speak, but what do you think, is there going to be one cocktail that can promote?
That's another brilliant question, and you're absolutely right. If you want to regenerate a heart, you're not just regenerating cardiomyocytes. You're not just regenerating a vasculature, but there's other cells involved too. Well, you still need the fibrous skeleton of the heart. You do need the fibroblasts. You need innervation. And so you raise you need vascular smooth muscle cells. So your question is, okay, you're focused on the vasculature. Deepak Srivastava is focused on cardiomyocytes. And I think ultimately what we need to get to, we chose the vasculature because that's what we know. That's really why we chose the vasculature. But what we really should be aiming for is transdifferentiating fibroblasts into cardiovascular progenitors. So there is a cell type during development that can differentiate into vascular smooth muscle, endothelial cell, and cardiomyocyte. It's called the cardiovascular progenitor, CVP. It's been described. We just don't know enough about it. I don't know how to make a fibroblast into a cardiovascular progenitor. But I think people are working in that direction. I think that ultimately might be a cocktail that would enhance the production of CVPs, would give you a cell that would be able to regenerate more of the heart. The other thing is, though, another approach would be to really try to recreate what's going on in the zebrafish and in newts when you damage a tissue. What happens when you cut the limb of a newt or you cut the heart, what happens actually in that area is that all the cells de-differentiate. They all de-differentiate and they proliferate, and then they re-differentiate. They remember what they were. So when you cut the limb of a newt, for example, it's been clearly shown by cell lineage tracing that the skin cells, the muscle cells, the bone cells, they de-differentiate. They become this blastema that proliferates and starts to form this limb. But when they re-differentiate, they remember what they were. It's probably this epigenetic memory, some traces of markings, histone markings that allow them to become what they were before after this proliferative phase.
Other questions?
Yes. I have a couple questions. When you talk about the Goldilocks zone, but what about the timing associated, that there may be a necessity for too much or too little inflammation, maybe in the beginning or maybe towards the end? Have you tested timing in terms of this, in addition to this Goldilocks zone, or do you think there needs to be that Goldilocks zone the entire time, especially when talking about macrophages and debridement of the wound and then switching of the macrophage polarization to now allow for healing?
Yeah, that's a really good question, and we don't know anything about timing. We've been focusing on dosing. We haven't really worked out timing yet. Really, really good question. I don't have an answer.
And then for, you talked about TLR3 activation. Did mm-hmm. you notice any other TLRs?
Yeah, we've done this with TLR4 too. And so this is, I think, a global response of innate immune activation. It's not just TLR3. It's probably all the pattern recognition receptors can do this.
I find I almost understand everything you do, but not quite. You know, it's curious that the yield from fibroblasts to endothelial cells is so low. But is it possible that there is some heterogeneity in the fibroblasts such that some of them are not primed for conversion? And is there a way for you to look at the genes that are active at the beginning and then what's left behind to see whether those cells are different?
Very good question, Henry. It's a question that's been plaguing me for about 3 years now. We really need to do single cell analysis of the fibroblasts in the dish and find those that are, if those that are responding are those are different somehow. So that can be done. We just haven't gotten around to it. We should. Thanks.
Very nice. Another question.
Can I ask one more? Sorry. So you talked about iNOS being necessary for transdifferentiation, but what about it being sufficient? So if you took the proteins itself and then instead of doing poly-IC to find the Goldilocks zone, what about doing iNOS RNA in order to see if you get the same response? And then in that same vein, since hypoxemia induces hematopoiesis, do you think that may also play a role in generating the progress that you want to go towards your cardiovascular progenitor cell?
Yeah, it's a really good thought. We haven't done that experiment. What I can tell you, though, is that NO donors can't, so like nitroglycerin or nitroprusside or other NO donors, I can't do this trick. It actually is very compartmentalized. The iNOS travels to the nucleus. It binds to the epigenetic modifier, nitrosylates it. 20% of epigenetic modifiers have a binding site for iNOS. So I think this is a very important phenomenon that Xu has discovered, and it's compartmentalized. So blasting a cell with an NO donor won't work. So we thought about that. Could we just have a chemical approach? Doesn't seem like it. But good questions. We don't have the answers to all of that. Coming soon. Thank you.
Well, with that, really want to thank Dr. Cooke for an amazing presentation, stimulating, and we look forward for an update next year sometime, John.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you.